Kirby!
Hey, welcome to WACTS, the show where I talk about what my life is like before, during, and after having my first child. This week we're covering what we did from August 17th to August 25th, 2015. It's a little bit more than a week. It's episode 29. It's a very special one because, oh my god, folks, the whole reason I'm doing this thing, we are covering the during and the slightly after section of the having my first child thing. It happened. It happened this week. I had a pretty good feeling, if you watched last week's episode, that things were coming down to the wire. Liz's due date, again, was August 28th, though we originally put the due date at something like August 17th, so by some math, he either came a couple days late. He's born on August 19th, 5:41 a.m. By some math, he might have been 2 days late. By other math, he might have been 9 days early, something like that. Yes, August 28th, August 19th. I can do math. But my God, guys, I'm a father now. It's such a strange and wonderful and fantastic feeling already. There have been so many surprises already. My life has changed so much. I mean, that's the whole point of this, is tracking how my life changes and how my routine is changing. And man, yeah, I don't even think it makes sense this week to divide things up into categories. Let's just go chronologically and talk a little bit about these changes that have already occurred. I'll flash to just today for a second, just to give a sense of a snapshot of how things have changed. I spent so much time today trying to just get my computer working this morning. A nurse had come over to speak to Liz for a couple hours about, you know, various mother things. And then my laptop, I tried to install a driver for the touchpad that just crashed the whole thing. And I spent the entire day trying to fix that while, of course, you know, trying to juggle some baby stuff here and there. And in many cases, I'd probably be pretty miserable and incredibly frustrated by this because I didn't make any progress. Like, I spent literally 12 hours today working on this, and now my final result of this is just that I am now grabbing all the important files and refactorizing the entire system, which is something I really try to avoid doing, and usually I can. Usually I try out enough things, trial and error, and can make it work. Point being, normally that'd be something that frustrates me to no end, really kind of makes me angry, and yet I'm totally at peace with it right now. It's like minor inconvenience, but when I look at my wife now, and I look at my son, it makes me so incredibly happy and content and grateful, and little things like that just pale in comparison now. It's really, really wonderful. So let's talk a little bit about the experience. So where I last left you in this whole baby extravaganza, I guess that's what we'll probably call this episode, baby extravaganza. We had stopped by the hospital because we thought that maybe the baby was coming last Sunday. Of course, we knew that wasn't actually the case. We had a pretty intense few days, like just, a lot of pre-labor stuff. And here's the thing, and this will carry through the whole labor process. My big concern going into the whole, you know, being supportive of my wife, giving birth, all that kind of stuff, was that I always thought that as a guy, not as, you know, a genuine participant in the process, that most of the experience would be me watching my wife be in a lot of pain and just me kind of feeling frustrated and upset and sad that I couldn't help her. That ended up not being really true at all. There was a lot for me to be doing leading up to the labor and then the labor itself. For example, my wife felt a lot of the labor pain in her back, and so something that we learned during our, you know, one day labor class or pregnancy class was how to apply counter pressure and how to do a certain kind of massaging that helps a lot with that. And so, by golly, if my wrist wasn't about to fall off by, you know, 5:41 a.m. on Wednesday of last week when our son finally came, because that was a really productive thing I was able to do for several days in a row. Just whenever a contraction or anything like that was coming, there were different spots that I could apply just the right amount of pressure to. And I'll say as a general note, I've heard a number of fathers and a number of guys talk about how leading up to the pregnancy, leading up to the labor, leading up or, you know, after the labor and in the days following and in those first couple months, that there's not a lot for the guy to do. And I'm not finding that to be true. There's still a lot of stuff the guy can do. Just because, you know, we as men aren't able to feed the baby and the baby might not be as interested in us, you know, we can bring things to our wife, we can give our wife a nice massage, we can carry the baby, we can hold the baby if he's being fussy. We can change diapers. There's plenty of very proactive things as a guy we can still do to be involved in this process. Anyway, I keep seeing I'm jumping so much into like what my life is like now. Let's go back a little bit. Let's go back to leading up to it. I totally forgot this and just predicted it now. Or just remembered that I had said this now. On Sunday, I don't know if I mentioned this in the last episode, I had joked with my wife that the baby was gonna come on Wednesday. And it was just one of those things I just threw out there as a totally random, like, blah, blah, kind of thing. And what do you know, he did come Wednesday. Pretty early in the morning, but yeah, that's kind of cool. I was right about that. Monday, let's go to Monday now. So Monday of last week, the 17th, I went to work. My wife wasn't sleeping at all at that point, and so I felt a little bit bad abandoning her, but of course I wanted to save my 6 days, vacation days, all these, you know, time off days for my office for after the baby came. So it didn't look like he was going to come Monday, so I went to my office, made it pretty clear that, you know, things were moving along and things could happen pretty much any time. And so my office pretty quickly was like, okay, well, here's the stuff we'd really like you to be able to get done. And it was a really tough balance because there was obviously these things that I knew I needed to get done for my office and I really wanted to get them done. But of course I kept telling myself, don't worry, your wife's not going to give birth until the 28th, you got plenty of time, relax. And of course, you know, another voice in my head was like, not true, he's coming any minute now. Talking to people in my office on Monday, they kind of, I think, tried to hammer that home a little bit, like, maybe you should really get stuff done. Of course, I was trying to balance that with trying to get the Spider-Gwen trailer done, which is a really fun project, but obviously, you know, not a particularly financially lucrative one, and of course should not take any time away from my office. So Monday I tried to get as much done I could, working on something for Rice down in Texas, working on a Park Avenue Armory mezzanine study thing, both projects that kind of filled me with anxiety in different ways. I think I talked about that a little bit last week. And then went home. Liz's mom arrived, what was it? Yeah, it was Monday night. She arrived pretty late Monday night, because she kind of, you know, in her wonderful instincts, kind of knew things were going to be happening soon, and so she was great to have around. Right from the start, I felt an immediate sense of calm knowing she was there, because it's just like, she knows what to do. She's a nurse practitioner, she's worked in labor rooms and stuff like that in the past, and has just a wonderfully calming influence on Liz. So that also put me at ease, and was a great experience to have her around. And as you'll see, that followed through the whole experience. So Monday morning, I will say, I was kind of running late to leave in the morning, and you know, I was just about to go out the door, and like, I probably could have caught my train by a couple minutes. And I was looking at Liz, and she's like in a lot of pain and really, you know, taking this like a champ. And I just thought, like, oh man, I really don't want to leave her like this right now. And so what I did was I missed my train there and spent another, you know, 20 minutes just trying to massage it out and trying to help her relax a little bit more. And I'm glad I did that, since that ended up being the last day that I went to work. Tuesday, woke up and was about to go to work, and Becky, after looking at, you know, Liz's state and all that, basically said, you shouldn't go to work today, Alex. And I was like, oh, really? Okay, because there's still a lot of stuff I'm supposed to do. And so then all of a sudden I'm in this crisis mode where it's like, oh God, there's stuff I need to do for my office that no one else really knows how to do because I've been working on these projects, but my God, I'm having a baby that's way more important and I need to be there for my wife. And that kind of struggle was a really weird one where on, you know, a rational level, it's like, yeah, just don't worry about your office, focus on the baby. But then it's like, oh, I don't want people to have to do extra work because I'm not, you know, getting my stuff done early. But I did get some done, to be fair. I was working from home using SplashDot, promoting into my office, and got a fair amount of the stuff done, not quite as much as I was hoping to. And then around, let's say 12:36, finally Becky was timing Liz's contractions and was like, I think it's coming now. So we headed over to the hospital. And, you know, apparently this thing can happen sometimes in the wild as well. If someone moves to a different location when they're, you know, nearing a birth, their contraction period can actually change. And so Becky was timing Liz's contractions 2-3 minutes apart, which absolutely is a time to go to the hospital. And then she got there, and then they were 5 minutes apart, 7 minutes apart, 10 minutes apart. And I was like, oh, okay, so they've sent us home. And by the way, there's, I'll tell you, all in all, we ended up going to the hospital 3 times. And what is hilarious, kind of awful about that is, of course, our road is so horribly bumpy, and to put Liz through, you know, six trips in a lot of pain, labor pain, back and forth along our bumpy road, I felt so bad. So, you know, by the time we went the third time, it was like, okay, we need to make sure that this is it. And so what happened is, yeah, so this was the second time. This was Wednesday, probably around 2:33, I guess, we came back home. And yeah, then we just were trying to do things here where we're working with like the yoga ball thing. We're finding different positions and different foods, drinks, trying to, you know, keep her hydrated. It was really hard for her to drink anything. So ice chips are a good way to go there. Liz's sister had arrived at that point. She was really fantastic in helping Liz with breathing. You know, and there's, of course, if you watch movies and that kind of thing, there's always the person being like, okay, breathe, 1, 2, 3, breathe, which could be horrible if you don't like that sort of thing, as I imagine most people don't. And so what Katie did, which was great, was rather than saying anything like that, to help Liz with her breathing and to, you know, make sure that she didn't tense up too much and making sure that her pacing was good and that she could slow down, all Katie did was breathe at the pace and speed and kind of intensity that Liz should be going at. And so, of course, as things got more and more intense for her, that just gave her something really simple to focus on. And I think that's a great technique. I recommend that to anyone who might be in that kind of situation. And by the way, anything I'm talking about, this is from my own personal experience, and you know, obviously take anything I say as a totally personal, my story, not representative of any medical opinions or anything like that. But feel free to use some of these techniques and take some lessons from this little journey that we've had in this past week, because a lot of really cool stuff happened, and we learned a lot too. Moving on. So we're there and we're trying to distract Liz. We're watching Lord of the Rings. We're trying to find, you know, cold things to eat, and I was actually bouncing back and forth trying to get some stuff done. I'll be honest, I was actually working, I finally had like an hour break when I needed to relax my wrist, and Katie kind of took over for me, and Becky was helping Liz, and so I'm like, okay, you know, we got this three-person cycle, so I needed a break. I went off. I actually worked on last week's episode of WACTS for like an hour, and that actually helped me a lot just to give me something else, and then going back, I felt renewed and reinvigorated, and then before I knew it, it was about 11:30, and Becky was like, oh, okay, Liz's water broke. And so that's a good time to go to the hospital, even though the contractions actually didn't ever get regular. So that's an interesting thing. You know, they make it sound like the primary thing you're going to be expecting when you go to the hospital is, I forget the exact numbers, but something like contractions like 2 to 3 minutes apart every five, or no, I guess, you know, I was going to say 2 to 3 minutes apart lasting 5 minutes. That doesn't make sense. 2 to 3 minutes apart lasting, I don't know, a minute, and that, having it been going on for an hour or something like that. So that was not our experience at all. The contractions never really got particularly regular, but when water breaks, that's a great time to go to the hospital. So we did that, arrived there around 11:30 Tuesday night, so this was the 18th, and yeah, they were like, okay, you guys are staying, good. We had to go in through the emergency room door, put Liz in the wheelchair, all that cool stuff, went up, found ourselves in a friendly room for what we were hoping for, because what's really cool about the, I'm always going to get this wrong, New York Hudson Valley Presbyterian Hospital Medical Center, is that they have so many wonderful amenities in their labor center, for birth, including like tubs. They've got, you know, all sorts of different stools of different heights and chairs and, you know, just a really kind of accommodating room. And, the room that we were in at like 2:30 or something like that, and on Sunday, was much more kind of cramped there, and there was no tub, nothing like that. So it was like, oh, I hope it doesn't happen in here. Now we had like the whole shebang. And so, you know, I'm not going to go into intimate detail about what happened between midnight and 5:30 a.m., but I'll say a few things. Again, Becky was amazing at helping to keep Liz calm, helping Liz stay focused. Katie was great at breathing. I did my best to help out with massaging. We used the tub, we used different positions. We actually had to work a little bit on the baby was coming out sunny side up, which means he's like flipped 180 degrees from how you want him to come out. And so then there were a bunch of other positions we had to work on that were, the idea was to turn them. And I think that was the most painful. Yeah, but you know, all I can say, here's the important thing. When it finally came down to it, and Liz really had to push and, you know, make that baby come out, I have never been more astounded by my wife. Like, it was such an incredible experience. She was like a superhero, really. Like, there's this intensity and this power and this sounds dumb, a can-do attitude, this incredible focus that, you know, you don't see in people in any kind of normal situation. There's a laser-like quality to that final, I'm gonna call this the final hour of pushing, and, you know, she was getting like 4 pushes per contraction, and when I first saw my son's head, it was the most incredible experience in the world. And then to see Liz, you know, produce this living person that, you know, is crying and alive and there with Liz and there with me, and it was such a powerful high. It was I knew it was going to be an emotional experience, but I was just I couldn't stop weeping. I couldn't stop weeping when it happened, because, you know, you go through this 9-month period with this abstract, kicky monster thing inside a belly that, you know, really doesn't seem that real. It seems like it could be a toy, some kind of gimmick thing. And then there he is. He's a living person with tiny fingernails, wrinkly hands, big feet, my feet, yeah! You know, nose, eyes, and he's a real person. He's a real person all of a sudden, and there he is, and all of a sudden, you are now responsible for keeping him alive. And obviously, that's something I've thought about a lot over the past 9 months, but it sets in so quick, like, wow, I need to really put this at the front of my priorities list now. Like, here is a person that will not survive without us. We are Liz is the most important person in his life, but we as a team are the most important people to him, to this person that is, for all intents and purposes, helpless. And there's an incredible responsibility and honor that comes with that. And it's thrilling, it's terrifying, it's thrilling, it's wonderful. And so what happened after that is, you know, Katie and Becky said their goodbyes for a little bit, and we were so grateful for them. Liz and I went off, we were moved to a different room, where it was basically like a hospital hotel room. By the way, the food, I'm just gonna say this, the food at the hospital, not bad. We, you know, moved in there around 9 a.m. Wednesday morning. We have the baby, we had a bunch of tests done on him, we had feet prints, you know, different kinds of shots and all that. And, oh, by the way, when he first came out, I really thought that when babies were first born that there's, like, crazy crying going on. And he wasn't crying that much. Like, actually, I think less than what you're supposed to have with crying, because, of course, there's still all this fluid in their throat and they need to clear that out. And so I think there was actually a little bit of attempting to make him cry. But yeah, those first few moments, I'm skipping around so much, but those first few moments seeing him were so magical. Like, you know, to have that eye contact, to have him holding my finger, to be able to hold him, to see Liz with him, to see that whole dynamic. So wonderful. Really, really an incredible experience. And nothing prepares you for it. I've had so many people tell me what it was like for them, and still, it's unlike anything else. It cannot be described. It cannot be replicated in any form except that experience. So anyway, so we're in our hospital hotel room. We stayed there until Saturday afternoon, which sounds like a long time, because originally, you know, it was Wednesday morning and someone had said, like, okay, you guys will be gone Thursday. So it's like, okay, like 24 hours, that seems like a reasonable recovery period. Liz had done so well, you know, and she still seemed like she had a fair amount of energy and strength, all things considered. I guess I expected her to be more wiped out, and to be fair, of course she was, but, you know, she could walk around. I thought that was amazing, and that was really cool. Now, in the hospital, though, the reason we ended up having to stay a little bit longer was Alistair Nicholas Edward Coulombe. I haven't even said his name yet. Alistair Nicholas Edward Coulombe, born 5:19 a.m. on August 19th, 2015, 7 pounds, 11 ounces. Had some jaundice, which is like the most common thing that babies have. It can happen from dehydration. It can happen from, you know, blood pooling in different areas from, you know, the whole labor process. And so we just had to put him under these crazy spaceship lights for a little bit. And that was basically to help him, you know, not, what's the opposite of absorb, diffuse, osmosize out the Billy Rubin, which is a hilarious name for, you know, this weird pigmentation in the skin. So he's a little bit yellow. We're really nervous about the whole idea of not being able to stay with him, because we thought he was going to be moved to the NICU. Oh, that was the other thing, is his breathing was really fast at first. So they thought, oh yeah, maybe he needs some closer attention. But, you know, this hospital is so amazing. Like, they knew, obviously, we wanted to spend as much time with him as possible. They wanted to avoid moving him to the NICU if they could. But of course, you know, the baby's safety is the most important thing. So here's what happened. They monitored the breathing really closely. We had some skin-to-skin time, which definitely helped regulate everything from his temperature to his heart rate to his breathing. And they started to see it come down. And they, after monitoring, they said, okay, that's fine. And then for the Billy Rubin, which, you know, the idea was that Liz and I were actually discharged from the hospital on Friday, but the idea was that they could have kept him in the NICU, but so that we could stay with him, we basically got to stay another day as his guests. And so I think for insurance purposes or something like that, that works out great, especially because they kept feeding us. And by the way, reading all this food, I'm thinking, like, how much is this going to cost? And apparently it's just kind of covered in the stay, which is wonderful. And again, the food was really good. Great cheeseburgers, great pudding, great fish, great chicken. We had all sorts of things. Great cranberry juice, too. What am I saying? And so, yeah, so the idea was that instead of hauling off to the NICU, you know, and not being able to see him and not being able to feed him and all that stuff for more than a day, they actually they moved us to a bigger room, because we were actually in a handicapped room at first with a giant bathroom and a relatively small other space. Liz had a nice bed. I was sleeping on this bizarre but fascinating, like, pull-out chair thing, which, yeah, I was looking at it going, like, that'd be kind of a cool thing to have at a house. Also, it'd be really weird to have that in a house. I don't know if I have a picture of it somewhere, maybe. So they moved us to a bigger room. They moved in this big, crazy spaceship UV light thing to put him in, and we were nervous about leaving him in there because, you know, the idea was that he needed, like, full three-hour blocks in there, uninterrupted. And then, you know, he could feed for like half an hour every 3 hours. But, you know, if he starts crying or something like that, like, you want to take him out and comfort him. And so this is where we went back on one policy we were going to try to enforce, which was we were going to try to do no pacifiers if we could. No pacifiers, but because, yeah, it's really tough to see him in there totally uncomforted. And so we let him have pacifiers while in there, and that definitely helped him a lot. And yeah, I mean, this is a baby that really loves to suck. I mean, when he didn't have a pacifier, he's like putting his whole hand in his mouth and aww. And I think as Liz's mom said, of course, though, it's a lot easier to take away a pacifier than take away the thumb or something like that, to cut it off, cut him off from a pacifier, cut him off thumb. I don't know. So Liz stayed in the hospital the entire time. We had some great visitors. Liz's mom brought us some frozen yogurt from Sweet Frog, which is in a little mini mall like right by the hospital, which is great. And I got to have some Nona's pizza, which is also amazing. And our neighbors came by with their two daughters who are going to be babysitting for us, and that was wonderful. We got an awesome edible arrangement thing from Brooke and Peter, my stepsister, and that was awesome. And we just felt so loved and comforted, and we're so grateful that our families and friends are so behind us on this. And of course, you know, no one really lives that close to us, but and again, that's why it was great that Liz's mom and sister were here. But yeah, it feels really good to have this experience, which I think could be really quite terrifying and lonely if you don't have a lot of support around, especially, God, to be a single mother. I mean, my heart goes out to anyone dealing with that. There's a reason it takes two people to make a baby, because you really need at least that. I mean, what's that expression? It takes a village. I think it really does. And we'll be experiencing that, I think, even more, of course, as little Alistair gets older. But yeah, by the way, Alistair, you may be curious where that name came from. It's a name both Liz and I like a lot. We've known Alistairs in our life that were good people, because let's be honest, if you have a name you like, but there's a person you knew with that name who you really hated, like, you're always going to associate your kid with that other person, and that's kind of rough. So anyway, Alistair, name we both really like. We decided we wanted to go with the Scottish spelling, not the Irish spelling. The Irish spelling is the A-L-I-S-T-A-I-R. We decided to go with the Irish Gaelic version, the non-anglicized version, because we like traditional things, A-L-A-S-D-A-I-R. And I didn't realize this until a few days after he was born, that, oh my God, his teachers are going to hate him. I had enough trouble going through school just trying to help people pronounce Coulombe, my last name, C-O-U-L-O-M-B-E, and now he is going to have to explain his first name and his last name, because people are going to wonder, is it pronounced like Alistair? Is it, you know, what's the history behind it? Blah, 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 blah. So he's got a crazy Gaelic-Scottish first name and then a hard-to-pronounce French-Canadian last name. Good for him. I wish him the best of luck with that. Nicholas, one of his middle names, of course, is my brother Nick. It's another Greek name. I promised my mom we'd have something Greek in there, so there's that is. Edward is a family name on Liz's side, particularly with her dad and brother and grandfather and all that, so that's great. And then Coulombe, there's the last name. So just to wrap up the hospital time, I just want to say that it could not have been a better experience. Everyone there, the nurses, Liz's midwife, Joanne, was incredible. So much support and love and caring. Like, you really felt like the entire staff there. And of course, they see people in all different states of duress and pregnancy and child rearing there every single day. And you'd think that it would become very routine to them. But there was such a genuine sense during our stay there that every nurse, every person who passed by, you know, we got to speak to Linda again, the lactation consultant, who was also the woman who gave us our whole, you know, day of birthing class. Everyone there just felt so much like they cared, like they really cared, like they really wanted to make sure you were okay, like you knew everything you needed to know, and if you had any questions, they genuinely wanted to answer it. Nothing felt by the numbers. It really was kind of a going the extra mile sort of thing, so we're so grateful for that. Anyway, so yeah, just one more quick thing. I had stayed at the hospital the whole time. I left the hospital a couple times. A, because I was starting to get cabin fever. B, because I really missed our animals and wanted an opportunity to be able to start to introduce to them the idea of the baby coming. And so Liz had a great idea. Oh, what if I brought a piece of the baby's clothing home? So I took his little hat, brought that home. Showed it to Sadie. Sadie smells it. She's very interested. I showed it to the cats. They couldn't care less. But then Sadie keeps following it around and being very interested in it. Like the third time I showed it to her, she tried to eat it. Nope, don't do that, Sadie. But that was really great. And, you know, Liz's mom was watching the house. She was walking Sadie. I was just so curious what it would be like to finally have that dynamic all together. And, you know, to be looking in that nursery and being like, oh my God, we spent all this time setting this thing up, and now we know exactly who's going in there and exactly what he looks like. How incredible. And so, yeah, Saturday we got to put the little guy in a car seat in our Pathfinder, drive home. I drove so slow, so carefully. I'm sure everyone behind me was not happy. There we were. We brought him in. We showed him to the animals. We changed a few diapers. We put him in his crib. We moved there's like a portable kind of crib thing, courtesy of Liz's dad, that we moved into our room. It's like a Chico playpen thing that has like 9 different stages. And we couldn't figure out how to get this like top bassinet thing working. And the problem was we had it upside down, because we're like, oh no, it keeps buckling. We can't put him in this if it keeps buckling. If you have something that buckles like this and you flip it over, oh, there you go. It's less buckly. That's cool. So yeah, we've been having him sleep in our room. And yeah, that first night, I mean, of course we were exhausted when we came home, but so magical and incredible and exciting, terrifying, all these words I keep using, they're so true, because now your entire life has changed. Now you have a person you need to take care of, and when he's crying in the middle of the night, you can't ignore him. I mean, you could, it'd be kind of terrible. You have to comfort him. And so, you know, of course, Liz is burdened with the responsibility of feeding him pretty regularly, and so, yes, there's not much I can do there, but, yeah, I mean, if he's just being fussy, if he needs a diaper change, like, that's my time to shine. I will say that I've had kind of the magical ability so far to, if he's got a clean diaper and I start holding him, by the time I'm done, there's no longer nothing in there. So that's been interesting. Today, by the way, I got like peed at for the first time, like right in my face. So that was fun. Here you go. Here's the thing. I did think that I might be a little bit grossed out by the diaper situation, and it would take some getting used to. Really not true. I've heard a lot of guys talk about how horrible it is. It's really not that bad, everyone. I'll say the first few days are, it's a different kind of diaper situation because he's still got like a bunch of amniotic fluid and everything. So what's coming out of him is kind of like black. It's pretty sticky. It's almost like a tar or paste. And so that's not that fun to clean when it gets in all the crevices and under his male parts and all that. But then, you know, once he starts feeding more, it becomes well, pink, first of all, which is kind of bizarre, pink or orange. And then it's actually much easier to clean because it's pretty milky and not that hard to wipe. You have a few baby wipes, you have your diapers, all that's fine. Until his umbilical cord heals, by the way, we are sticking with disposable diapers. Organic seventh generation, you know, non-environmental hurtful ones, hooray. And then I think after his umbilical cord is totally healed, then we will start doing our cloth diaper thing. And hopefully we can get into a rhythm with that and not need to, you know, be throwing out 12 diapers a day or whatever number we're approaching now. But yeah, you know, these past few days have been an adjustment period. The first night we actually slept pretty well. The second night, where are we now? So we're talking Saturday night. The Sunday night, he kind of started to figure out, like, oh, wait a minute, if I feel lonely or want attention or anything, like, oh, I can just kind of make some really loud sounds and someone's going to come play with me. Uh-oh. But yeah, there was a lot of fussing Sunday night. I don't think Liz and I got more than half an hour, 40 minutes of sleep in any given period. So we were pretty exhausted on Monday. Thank God I wasn't going to work that day. So what I'm doing with my office, by the way, is I pretty much said, hey, as soon as the baby's coming, let's start a two-week time off period there. Now, that's very interesting to have happening now since my office has summer Fridays. So basically, I worked half a day Tuesday. And basically, you know, because Fridays are already off for my office, like, I'm not going to push that further. And I do want to save time off for when my son is a little bit older and can do more things and I can, you know, have a more active, engaging time with him. So I don't want to use too many days off right now. But I think I'll be going back to work one day this week. So again, Fridays are off this week. So I think I'll go back Thursday. Today is Tuesday, by the way. And that'll be good just to drop in and give Liz one day to try to figure out how things could work when I'm not around to help out. And then I'll do a three-day week the next week, and I'll just kind of ease back into it. But what's nice is this is happening at, like, the perfect time in the year where I think I have enough. Again, I'm using sick days, personal days, and vacation days. And I have just enough of those, I think, that if I really wanted to, I could have three-day weekends pretty much clear through the rest of the year. I think I'm like one or two short of that, but because of Thanksgiving and the way our office usually does the Christmas and New Year's, I could really spend a significant amount of time home, which is what I want to do. I want to be helpful to Liz. I want to help us, you know, ease into this new environment. I want to be able to help out around the house, get things done, and of course be there for my son. And then, you know, next year, January 1st, I'll have all sorts of new sick days and vacation days to use, so that'll be great too. Anyways. Hey, do you want to meet him? You want to meet him? Okay, let's bring him out. Just very briefly, here we go. What did I say? Remember last week? I was like, wouldn't it be cool if there was a baby next week? Well, here we are next week, and there's a baby. Pretty cool how life works out that way sometimes, huh? And this particular baby is hiccuping, and it's adorable. And, you know, I sort of thought hiccuping would be something that would really upset a baby, but he seems totally cool with it. He's just chill, making faces, just hiccuping as he goes. I find that pretty wonderful. This guy is everything I hope for and more. I'm sure to you, the casual viewer, he looks like every other baby in the world. It's amazing when you're a parent how special and unique and all the little intricacies of your child become very dear to you. I know so much now about, like, all the little crinkles in his face and his hairline and his eyelashes and his nose and his little jawline kind of thing going, which I think that's probably for feeding, that kind of thing. But this little guy, I'm going to have to put him to bed, so he won't be here for most of the episode, but take a look at him. You know, that's my son. This is baby Alistair. And here's the cats waiting to pounce on him. Got to be careful now with the coyotes outside. You know, got like fresh meat here. I'm sure they can smell him. Got to be really careful. So, going on those walks. Got to bring a baseball bat. Got to be super protective. Look, and we can dance. We can sing. Lay down a beat for me.
Lay me down a beat. Lay me down a beat.
You're pretty awesome.
I said, yo, here is my son. He's here in a yellow blanket and number one. Hiccup and solo.
Yeah, all right. You know, you spend so much time growing up and looking at puppies and kittens and other babies and all these cute things, and then all of a sudden, here is a living, breathing, super cute thing that my wife and I made. That's amazing. And of course, yeah, he's a person with a soul and feelings and all that, but he's super cute. And yeah, there's some pride to be taken in just making something this friggin' adorable. So, yeah. You know, some people have a bunch of lullabies they sing to their children. I'm finding that if he's having trouble sleeping or if he's being fussy, that's a great opportunity for me to just freestyle, improvise, and just sing whatever the heck I want about what's in the room, whatever's on my mind. It could be handlebars on the ceiling when I know Gatorade is going to be drunken every night. And the baby's in my arms and he's trying to go to sleep, but he can't because he is hiccuping. Pooch, he's hiccuping. Pooch. And soon he will not just need to go to sleep because he keeps hiccuping and he just keeps hiccuping and he'll never stop hiccuping.
True song.
And he'll never stop hiccuping.
Never
and he'll never stop hiccuping. Oh, I know. Oh, I know, that if we go marching down the street, there will be coyotes outside. So yeah, the past few days have been an adjustment period, especially with the sleep thing, trying to find times during the day to nap. I'm not a great napper. I think I'm going to have to become one if I have any hope of getting my various side projects done and home projects in addition to helping out the baby and going to work. So we'll see how that works out. So far, I think I slept too much yesterday on Monday, maybe like 2 to 3 hours, and then I had trouble going to sleep. So I worked on the Spider-Gwen stuff. We'll talk more about that in a minute. But yeah, let's go through a few more random baby things. We're pretty much caught up to the present. You're kind of hearing the major beats of the story. Yesterday we took him to his pediatrician for the first time. Really wanted him to have a good pediatrician. I loved my pediatrician growing up. His name was Dr. Bishop, and he had such a warm, kind, generous heart and spirit. And I look forward to doctor's appointments with him. That's how cool he was. The sound you're hearing right now is Zoe playing around in a box. She's gonna get spayed tomorrow. That's gonna be great. So the doctor Liz picked out, Dr. Gurgley, amazingly, he's only about 7 minute drive away from us, which is great because, you know, we're in the middle of the woods. And we're going to be having quite a few appointments with him early on. So this one was basically just all the basics, taking his weight, measurements, you know, talking about shots, all that kind of stuff. There was a little bit of confusion, by the way, where we didn't give Alistair a hepatitis shot at the hospital because our understanding was that was going to happen at the doctor's office when we first got there, but apparently they don't give him one for 2 months, so we're a little bit nervous about that, but they're like, you know what, if you don't have hepatitis, your wife doesn't have hepatitis, don't worry about it, just, you know, be careful in grocery stores. So hopefully that'll be okay. Oh, by the way, flashing back to the pregnancy really quick, I got my whooping cough vaccine on Monday at the New York Medical Clinic. Oh, why can't I remember what it's called? A great walk-in clinic. I've never been to one before. This was great. It took like 20 minutes during my lunch break to go in there and get my Tdap and, you know, feel like, okay, now I can have my child. And I had this voice in my head all day Monday, like, maybe you should do this today. And me going, no, it's fine. I have till August 28th. And I'm glad I did it Monday, of course. And that allowed for a little bit of humor during the whole labor process, because Liz is there, of course, in the most intense, agonizing pain. And I'm there like, you know, Liz, my arm really hurts. You know, it pales in comparison, of course. A few other random things. Sunday, we took him to a book fair. Book fair was amazing. He was quiet the entire time. This is actually a thing we went to a year ago at the Desmond Fish Library. They do this incredible thing mid-August every year where they do this huge book sale, and things start out like, you know, $1 for hardcover books, half 50 cents for paperback books, and they have this huge variety. They've got some movies, video games, all that cool stuff. And then each day during the week, they keep dropping the price and dropping the price. And we were there on Sunday, where it was $5 per box. And if you really want to be a jerk about it, you can bring in a huge box, and it's still going to be $5. And then Monday, everything's free. So we went Sunday, and we were like, oh, can we do this? Can we bring Alistair? It's like our first trip out. And he loves this Chico car seat, which comes with like the stroller that we have for him. And he sleeps amazingly in it just the entire time. So he was hanging out there. We were at the book fair for an hour and a half, 2 hours. We bought, you know, $20 worth of books, which ended up being 200 pounds, something like that. And we want to have a huge library. Someday we'll just have a big turret attachment to the house, just a big turret library. And he was great. So anyway, that was really wonderful to be like, hey, we could take him out in public. And there were other babies crying in the library. And every time I heard a baby crying, I'm like, oh no, it's Alistair. And then it wasn't. He's right there kind of, you know, doing his little, ah. By the way, the only sounds he really makes right now are, ah. And then Liz heard him go, which I'm so sad I missed, because that sounds like the most adorable thing in the world. And it's really interesting, by the way, watching him make sounds when he's not making like fussy sounds. Like sometimes Liz and I are just talking, and he'll just make these little sounds that are just kind of like, I'm talking too. Like this is me having, you know, joining in the conversation, which is really amazing and cool. And to watch him starting to figure this stuff out, I'm really looking forward to watching him discover things. There have already been moments of that with him, you know, seeing things, being outside for the first time, seeing the cats, seeing our dog, and those little reactions. And, you know, his default expression right now, you know, he doesn't really smile or frown or anything like that. There's just kind of always like a suspicious, like, huh, kind of thing going on, like, what? And it's adorable and wonderful. And speaking of sounds, by the way, you know, there's this kind of incredible ventriloquism thing going on that I'm really fascinated by, where he can keep his face totally still, not move, not change expression at all, and then make this huge range of sounds. It's, and I can't even do it, but such a wide variety of sounds without doing anything with his face, you'd think he has like a little boombox in there or something. So that's really interesting. So anyway, library trip went really well. The road, speaking of him, you know, not waking up, I was so nervous about how he'd deal with our road. I just thought, you know, anytime we travel anywhere, maybe he's sleeping in the car, and then we start to come back, and then we'll hit our road, and he'll wake up, and then everything's going to be crying, and then we'll go to the house, and we'll always be in a bad mood. So far, he has done nothing but sleep when we're dealing with our road. And again, we live off this insane, insane dirt road. There was a huge thunderstorm one of the nights that we were in the hospital, and it washed out the road even worse, so it's even more horrible than it usually is, and it's impossible to drive on this road even if you're going 2 miles an hour without jostling everything everywhere. And he loves his car seat. Maybe he really likes being jostled like that, but he always sleeps right through it. We've had, I guess, 3 trips now with him back and forth on that road with the car, and then today we went out for a walk with him in a Moby wrap, which is really cool. Whoever invented the Moby wrap, you're amazing, and I know that you weren't doing that to make money, because there's not really a way to patent that, but perfect. And that entire walk, which again is pretty jostly, climbing over rocks and stones and wood and stuff, and he slept the whole time. So I'm feeling pretty good about him with the road. The only tricky thing, of course, is when Liz is alone, like she's going to be taking him to another pediatrician appointment next week, and having him in the car seat, like, she's been sitting in the back and I've been driving, and it's actually good that she's able to kind of hold his head a little bit, because, you know, baby's got really, really weak necks. Like, whenever I pick him up, I'm always so afraid of, like, his neck just, like, falling back. And, there's a really big head, like mine, and not a particularly strong neck. Mine's pretty strong. But, so we've got to be super careful of that, and so I'm kind of wondering, like, yeah, what's going to be the best thing to do when it's just Liz by herself driving him around? She doesn't want to have the, like, hand on the steering wheel while, like, holding his head or anything like that. But also, you know, I was like, oh, can we just tuck, like, some cushions or small pillows on either side of him? Apparently that's considered super dangerous. So hopefully we'll figure that out soon. Other random things. There are things that I really thought would bother me more that really haven't been. I mean, yes, the not sleeping thing is not great. Obviously, no one likes waking up at 3 a.m. I'm sure I'll get used to it. You know, I keep thinking about what Louis C.K. said about him being nervous about being a dad because he kind of hated babies. And then his daughters were born and, like, instantly he's in love with them and would do anything for them. And he talked about, like, yeah, I hate not being able to sleep, but it's worth it. And you get used to it and it's fine. And that's kind of how I'm feeling now. Similarly, I thought I'd be, and this is going to sound weird, but I thought I'd be more worried by hearing my baby cry. I expected to have this kind of instant reaction of like, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god, are you okay? And anxiety and stress, and you know, you'd think there'd be like a direct current between a baby's cry and their parents feeling horrible, like something needs to be done. And I don't know if it's like a skepticism thing or something like that, but like even when I know he really does need something, a diaper change, to eat, something like that, there's some other part of me that's like, he's fine, it's okay, like, I'm here, we're gonna take care of it. I don't feel a need to rush, I guess is what I'm saying. Like, nothing feels like an emergency so far. And so he can cry, and it doesn't bother me that much, which I guess is good and bad. It's good that it doesn't stress me out of my mind. It's maybe bad that I don't have more of like an instant, like, oh, we have to save you kind of reaction. But, yeah. And of course, you know, the whole point of this blog is talking about the things I'm able to do in addition to baby stuff. And, so let's get to that real quick.